like to have a little talk with you, Howard.
Sorry to keep you waiting. I'll be with you in a minute.
What's that, Howard?
Didn't you ever see one of these? Wire recorder.
Oh. Can we talk a minute?
Records things. Just got delivery yesterday. Been driving me crazy. The most terrific machine I ever saw in my life. I was up all night with it.
What do you do with it?
I bought it for dictation, but you can do anything with it. Listen to this. I had it home last night. Listen to what I picked up. The first one is my daughter. Get this. Listen to that kick whistle.
Well, that is lifelike, isn't it?
7 years old. Get that tone.
I'd like to ask a little favor, if you don't mind.
Get this now. This is my son.
Alabama is Montgomery, the capital of Arizona.
5 years old, Willy.
You'll make an announcer someday.
Capital of California.
Get that. Alphabetical order.
Colorado is Denver. The capital of...
Wait a minute. The maid kicked the plug out.
Well, it certainly is.
For God's sake.
It's a bit of a watch time, so I have to go to sleep.
That really is.
Wait a minute. The next is my wife.
Go on, say something. Were you going to talk?
Oh, I can't think of anything.
Well, talk. It's turning.
Hello? Oh, Howard, I can't talk into this.
That was my wife.
That is a wonderful machine. Can we please...
I tell you, Willie, I'm going to take my camera and my bandsaw and all my hobbies, and out they go. This is the most fascinating relaxation I ever found.
I think I'll get one myself.
Sure, they're only 100 and a half. You can't do without it. Supposing you want to hear Jack Benny, see? But you can't be at home at that hour, so you tell the maid to turn the radio on when Jack Benny comes on, and this automatically goes on with the radio.
And when you come home...
You can come home 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, anytime you like, and you get yourself a Coke, sit yourself down, throw the switch, and there's Jack Benny's program in the middle of the night.
Well, I'm definitely going to get one. Because lots of times I'm on the road and I think to myself, what I must be missing on the radio.
Don't you have a radio in the car?
Well, yeah, but whoever thinks of turning it on.
Say, aren't you supposed to be in Boston?
Well, that's what I want to talk to you about, Howard. You got a minute?
What happened? What are you doing here?
Well,
You didn't crack up again, did you?
Oh, no.
Jeez, you had me worried there for a minute. What's the trouble?
Well, tell you the truth, Howard, I've come to the decision that I'd rather not travel anymore.
Not travel? Well, what'll you do?
Remember Christmas time? When you had the party here? You said you'd try to think of some spot for me here in town.
With us?
Well, sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I remember. Well, I couldn't think of anything for you, Willie.
I'll tell you, Howard, the kids are all grown up, you know? I don't need much anymore. If I could take home, well, $65 a week, I could swing it.
Yeah, but Willie, see...
I tell you why, Howard, speaking frankly and between the two of us, you know. I'm just a little tired.
Oh, I could understand that, Willie. But you're a rolled man, Willie, and we do a rolled business. We've only got half a dozen salesmen on the floor here.
Well, God knows, Howard, I never asked a favor of any man, but I was with the firm when your father used to carry you here in his arms.
I know that, Willie.
But your father came to me the day you were born and asked me what I thought of the name Howard. May he rest in peace.
I appreciate that, Willie, but there is just no spot here for you. If I had a spot, I'd slam you right in. But I just don't have a single solitary spot.
Howard, all I need to set my table is $50 a week.
But where am I going to put you, kid?
Look, it isn't a question of whether I can sell merchandise, is it?
No, but it's a business, kid. And everybody's got to pull his own weight.
Just let me tell you a story, Howard.
Because you got to admit, business is business.
Oh, business is definitely business. But just listen for a minute. You don't understand this. When I was a boy, 18, 19, I was already on the road. And there was a question in my mind as to whether selling had a future for me, because in those days, I had a yearning to go to Alaska. See, there were 3 gold strikes in 1 month in Alaska, and I felt like going out, well, just for the ride, you might say.
Don't say.
Oh, yeah. My father lived many years in Alaska. He was an adventurous man. We've got quite a little streak of self-reliance in our family. I thought I'd go out with my older brother and try to locate him and maybe settle in the north with the old man. And I was almost decided to go when I met a salesman in the Parker House. His name was Dave Singleman. And he was 84 years old, and he'd drummed merchandise in 31 states. And old Dave, he'd go up to his room, understand, put on his green velvet slippers, I'll never forget, pick up his phone and call the buyers, and without ever leaving his room, at the age of 84, he made his living. And when I saw that, I realized that selling was the greatest career a man could want. Because what could be more satisfying than to be able to go at the age of 84 into 20, 30 different cities, pick up a phone, and be remembered and loved and helped by so many different people? Do you know, when he died, and by the way, he died the death of a salesman, in his green velvet slippers in the smoker of the New York, New Haven, and Hartford going into Boston, when he died, hundreds of salesmen and buyers were at his funeral. Things were sad on a lot of trains for months after that. In those days, there was personality in it, Howard. There was respect and comradeship and gratitude in it. Today, it's all cut and dried. There's no chance for bringing friendship to bear or personality, you see what I mean? They don't know me anymore.
That's just the thing, Willie.
Look, if I had $40 a week, that's all I need. $40, Howard.
Kid, I can't take blood from a stone.
Howard, the year Al Smith was nominated, your father came to
me. I've got to go see some people.
I'm talking about your father. There were promises made across this desk. You mustn't tell me you've got people to see. I put 34 years into this firm, Howard, and now I can't pay my insurance. You can't eat the orange and throw the peel away. A man is not a piece of fruit. Now, pay attention. Your father, in 1928, I had a big year. I averaged $170 a week in commissions.
Oh, now, Willie, you never averaged...
I averaged $170 a week in the year of 1928, and your father came to me, or rather, I was in his office here. It was right over this desk, and he put his hand on my shoulder.
You'll have to excuse me, Willie. I gotta see some people. Pull yourself together.
Gotta get myself some coffee. I'll get some coffee.
Willie, look.
I'll go to Boston.
Willie, you can't go to Boston.
Why can't I go?
I don't want you to represent us. I've been meaning to tell you for a long time now.
Howard, are you firing me?
I think you need a good long rest, Willie.
Howard.
And when you feel better, come back and... we'll see if we can work something out.
But I got to earn money, Howard. I'm in no position.
Where are your sons? Why don't your sons give you a hand?
They're working on a very big deal.
This is no time for false pride, Willie. You go to your sons and you tell them that you're tired. You got two great boys, haven't you?
No question, no question. But in the meantime,
then that's that, huh?
All right, I'll go to Boston tomorrow.
No, no.
I can't throw myself on my sons. I'm not a cripple.
Look, kid, I'm busy this morning.
Howard, you've got to let me go to Boston.
I've got a line of people to see this morning. Sit down, take 5 minutes, and pull yourself together. And then go home, will you? I need the office, Willie. Oh, yeah. Whenever you can this week, stop by and drop off the samples. You'll feel better, Willie. And then come back and we'll talk. Pull yourself together, kid. There's people outside.
Oh, Ben. How did you do it? What's the answer? Did you wind up the Alaska deal already?
Doesn't take much time if you know what you're doing. Just a short business trip. Boarding ship in an hour. Wanted to say goodbye.
Ben, I've got to talk to you.
Haven't the time, William.
Ben, nothing's working out. I don't know what to do.
Now, look here, William. I bought timberland in Alaska, and I need a man to look after things for me.
God, timberland? Well, me and my boys in those grand outdoors.
We have a new continent at your doorstep, William. Get out of these cities. They're full of talk and time payments and courts of law. Screw on your fists, and you can fight for a fortune up there.
Yes. Yes. Linda? Linda!
Oh, you're back.
I haven't much time.
No, wait. Linda, he's got a proposition for me in Alaska.
But you've got... He's got a beautiful job here.
But in Alaska, kid, I could...
You're doing well enough, Willie.
Enough for what, my dear?
Don't say those things to him. Enough to be happy. Right here, right now. Why must everybody conquer the world? You're well-liked, and the boys love you, and someday... Why, old man Wagner told him just the other day that if he keeps it up, he'll be a member of the firm, didn't he, Willie?
Sure, sure. I am building something with this firm, Ben. And if a man is building something, he must be on the right track, mustn't he?
What are you building? Lay your hand on it. Where is it?
That's true, Linda. There's nothing.
There's a man 84 years old.
Oh, that's right. Ben, that's right. When I look at that man, I say, what is there to worry about? No, it's true, Ben. All he has to do is go into any city, pick up the phone, and he's making a living. And you know why?
I've got to go.
No, look at my boy, Biff. Without a penny to his name. 3 great universities are begging for him. And from there, the sky's the limit, because it's not what you do, Ben. It's who you know. And the smile on your face. It's contacts, Ben. Contacts. The whole wealth of Alaska passes over the lunch table at the Commodore Hotel. And that's the wonder of this country. That a man can end with diamonds here on the basis of being liked. Oh, Ben, look at my boy Biff. When he walks into a business office, his name will sound out like a bell. And all the doors will open to him. I've seen it, Ben. I've seen it 1,000 times. You can't feel it with your hand like timber, but it's there.
Goodbye, William.
Ben, am I right? Don't you think I'm right? I value your advice.
There's a new continent at your doorstep, William. You could walk out rich. Rich!
No, we'll do it here, Ben. You hear me? We're gonna do it here!
Oh, gee, I was afraid you'd left already.
Why? What time is it?
Well, it's 1:30.
Well, come on, everybody. Ebbertsfield, next stop. Where's the penance?
Did you pack fresh underwear?
Come on, I want to go.
Biff, I'm carrying your helmet, ain't I?
No, I'm carrying the helmet.
Oh, Biff, you promised me.
I'm carrying the helmet.
Well, how am I going to get into the locker room?
Let him carry the shoulder guards.
Oh, can I, Biff? Because I told everybody I'm going to be in the locker room.
In Ebbertsfield, it's the clubhouse.
Well, I meant the clubhouse. Biff!
Biff!
Let him carry the shoulder guards.
Yeah.
Come stay close to us now.
Everybody wave when Biff comes out on the field. Are you setting on, boys?
Ready to go, Pop. Every muscle is ready.
You realize what this means.
That's right, Pop.
You're coming home this afternoon, captain of the All-Scholastic Championship team of the city of New York.
I got it, Pop. And remember, pal, when I take off my helmet, that touchdown is for you.
Let's go!
Hey, Willie!
Oh, I've got no room for you, Charlie.
Room for what?
In the car.
You going for a ride? I wanted to shoot some casino.
Casino. Don't you realize what today is?
Oh, he knows, Willie. He's just kidding you.
Or there's nothing to kid about.
Oh, Linda, what's going on?
He's playing in Ebbets Field.
Baseball in this weather?
Don't talk to him. Come on, come on.
Hey, wait a minute. Didn't you hear the news?
What?
Don't you listen to the radio? Ebbets Field just blew up.
Oh, you go to hell. Come on, come on. We're late.
Knock a homer, Biff. Knock a homer.
Yeah, well, I don't think that was funny, Charlie. This is the greatest day of his life.
Willie, when are you gonna grow up?
Yeah, huh? When this game is over, Charlie, you'll be laughing the other side of your face. They'll be calling him another Red Grange. $25,000 a year.
Is that so?
Yeah, that's so.
Well, then I'm sorry, Willie, but tell me something.
What?
Who is Red Grange?
God, who the hell do you think you are? Better than everybody else? You don't know everything, you big, ignorant, stupid...
Willie.
Put up your hand!
Willie.
What are you walking away from? Don't walk away. If you're gonna say something, say it to my face. I know you laugh at me behind my back. Well, you'll laugh out of the other side of your goddamn face after this game. People, touchdown! Right between the goalposts!
Say, Bernard, will you go out in the hall?
What is that noise? Who is it?
Mr. Loman. He just got off the elevator.
Well, who's he arguing with?
Nobody. There's nobody with him. I can't deal with him anymore. And your father gets all upset every time he comes. I've got a lot of typing to do, and your father's waiting to sign it. Will you see him?
Touchdown!
Mr. Loman?
Jenny. Jenny. Good to see you. How are you? Working or still honest?
Fine. How have you been feeling?
Not much anymore, Jenny.
Hello, Uncle Willy.
Bernard! Well, look who's here.
How are you? It's good to see you. Come in.
What are you doing here?
I just stopped by to see Pop. Get off my feet till my train leaves. I'm going to Washington in a few minutes.
Is he in?
Yes, he's in his office with the accountant. Sit down.
So, what are you going to do in Washington?
It's just a case I got there, Willie.
Is that so?
But Dad tells me Biff's in town.
Yeah, Biff's in. Working on a very big deal, Bernard.
What's Biff doing?
Well, he's been doing very big things in the West. But he decided to establish himself here very big. And we're having dinner. Did I hear your wife had a boy?
That's right, our second.
Two boys. What do you know?
What kind of a deal has Biff got?
Well, Bill Oliver. Very big sporting goods man. He wants Biff very badly. Called him in from the West, long distance, carte blanche, special deliveries.
And you still with the old firm, Willie?
I'm overjoyed to see how you made the grade, Bernard. Overjoyed. It's an encouraging thing to see a young man, really, really. Looks very good for Biff. Very. Bernard?
What is it, Willie?
What's the secret?
What secret?
How did you... Why didn't he ever catch on?
Oh, I wouldn't know that, Willie.
You were his friend, his boyhood friend. There's something I don't understand about it. His life ended after that Ebbets Field game. From the age of 17, nothing good ever happened to him.
He never trained himself for anything.
But he did. He did. After high school, he took so many correspondence courses. Radio, mechanics, television, God knows what. And never made the slightest mark.
Willie, do you want to talk candidly?
I regard you as a very brilliant man, Bernard. I value your advice.
Oh, the hell with advice, Willie. I could never advise you. There's just one thing I've always wanted to ask. When he was supposed to graduate and the math teacher flunked him...
Oh, that son of a bitch ruined his life.
Yeah, but, Willie, all he had to do was go to summer school and make up that subject.
That's right, that's right.
Did you tell him not to go to summer school?
Me? I begged him to go. I ordered him to go.
Then why wouldn't he go?
Why? Why, Bernard? That question has been trailing me like a ghost for the last 15 years. He flunked the subject and laid down and died like a hammer hit him.
Take it easy, kid.
No, let me talk to you. I got nobody to talk to. Bernard, was it my fault? You see, it keeps going around in my head. Maybe I did something to him. I got nothing to give him.
Now don't take it so hard.
Why did he lay down? What is the story there? You were his friend.
Willie, I remember it was June, and our grades came out, and he'd flunked math.
Yeah, that son of a bitch.
You know, it wasn't right then. Biff just got very angry, I remember, and he was ready to enroll in summer school.
He was?
He wasn't beaten by it at all. But then, Willie, he disappeared from the block for almost a month, and I get the idea that he'd gone up to New England to see you. And did he have a talk with you then? Willie?
Yeah. He came to Boston? What about it?
It's just that when he came back, I'll never forget this. It always mystifies me. Because I'd thought so well of Biff, even though he'd always taken advantage of me. I loved him, Willie, you know? And he came back after that month, and he took his sneakers. Remember those sneakers with University of Virginia printed on them? And he was so proud of those, wore them every day. And he took them down into the cellar and burned them up in the furnace. And we had a fist fight. It lasted at least half an hour, just the two of us punching each other down the cellar and crying right through it. I've often thought how strange it was that I knew then he'd given up his life. What happened in Boston, Willy? I just bring it up because you asked me.
Nothing. What do you mean, what happened? What's that got to do with anything?
Well, now, don't get sore.
Well, what are you trying to do, blame it on me? If a boy lays down, is that my fault?
Now, Willy, don't...
Well, don't. Don't talk to me that way. What does that mean? What happened?
Willy.
Charlie.
How do you like this kid? Gonna argue a case in front of the Supreme Court.
Oh, Pop.
No. The Supreme Court?
I gotta run. Goodbye, Dad.
Knock him dead, Bernard.
Goodbye, Willy.
Goodbye, boy. The Supreme Court. And he didn't even mention it.
He don't have to. He's gonna do it.
And you never told him what to do, did you? You never took any interest in him.
My salvation is that I never took any interest in anything. Here's some money. $50. Take it.
Charlie, look. I got my insurance to pay. If you can manage it, I need $110. I draw it from my bank, but Linda would know, and I'm...
Sit down, Willie.
I'm keeping an account of everything, remember. I'll pay every penny back.
Now listen to me, Willie.
I want you to know I appreciate...
Willie, what are you doing? What the hell is going on in your head?
Why? I'm simply...
I offered you a job. You can make $50 a week, and I won't send you on the road.
I've got a job.
Without pay? What kind of a job is a job without pay? Now, look, kid, enough is enough. I'm no genius, but I know when I'm being insulted.
Insulted?
Why don't you want to work for me?
What's the matter with you? I've got a job.
Then what are you walking in here every week for?
Well, if you don't want me to walk in here...
I am offering you a job.
I don't want your goddamn job.
When the hell are you gonna grow up?
You big ignoramus. If you say that to me again, I'll wrap you one. I don't care how big you are.
How much do you need, Willie?
Charlie, I'm strapped. I'm strapped. I don't know what to do. I was just fired.
Howard fired you?
That snot nose. Imagine that. I named him. I named him Howard.
Willie, when are you going to realize that them things don't mean anything? You named him Howard, but you can't sell that. The only thing you got in this world is what you can sell. And the funny thing is that you're a salesman and you don't know that.
I've always tried to think otherwise, I guess. I always felt that if a man was impressive and well-liked, that nothing...
Why must everybody like you? Who liked J.P. Morgan? Was he impressive? In a Turkish bath, he looked like a butcher. But with his pockets on, he was very well-liked. Now listen, Willie... I know you don't like me, and nobody can say that I'm in love with you, but I'll give you a job, because... Just for the hell of it, put it that way. Now, what do you say?
I just can't work for you, Charlie.
What, are you jealous of me?
I can't work for you, that's all. Don't ask me why.
You've been jealous of me all your life, you damned fool. Here, pay your insurance.
I'm keeping strict accounts.
I've got some work to do. Take care of yourself. And pay your insurance.
Funny, you know. After all the highways and the trains and the appointments and the years, you end up worth more dead than alive.
Willie, nobody's worth nothing dead. Did you hear what I said? Willie!
Apologize to Bernard for me when you see him. I didn't mean to argue with him. He's a fine boy. They're all... fine boys. And they'll all end up big, all of them. Wish me luck, Charlie. He saw Bill Oliver today.
Good luck.
Charlie, you're the only friend I got. Isn't that a remarkable thing?
Jesus.
So how's it coming, Stanley?
That's a dog's life.
I only wish during the war they took me in the army. I could have been dead by now.
My brother's back, Stanley.
Oh, he come back, eh? From the far west?
Yeah, big cattle man, my brother, so treat him right. My father's coming, too.
Oh, your father, too?
You got a couple of nice lobsters.
100% big.
I want them with the claws.
Don't worry, I don't give you no mice. How about some wine? It'll put ahead in the meal.
No, you remember, Stanley, that recipe I brought you from overseas with the champagne in it?
Oh, yeah, sure. I still got it tacked up yet in the kitchen. But that'll have to cost you $1 apiece anyways.
That's all right.
What, you hit a number or something?
No, it's a little celebration. My brother, I think he pulled off a big deal today. I think we're going into business together.
Great. That's the best for you. Because the family business, you know what I mean? That's the best.
That's what I think. Ooh, Stanley.
I think that's for you, Mr. Loman.
Look at that mouth. Oh, God, and the binoculars.
Jeez, you got a life, Mr. Loman.
Wait on her.
Would you like a menu, ma'am?
I'm expecting someone, but I'd like...
Why don't you bring her... Excuse me, miss. Do you mind? I sell champagne, and I'd like you to try my brand. Bring her a champagne, Stanley.
That's awfully nice of you.
Don't mention it. It's all company money.
That's a charming product to be selling, isn't it?
Oh, it gets to be like everything else. Selling is selling, you know.
I suppose.
You don't happen to sell, do you?
No, I don't sell.
Would you object to a compliment from a stranger? You ought to be on a magazine cover.
I have been.
Oh, what did I say, Stanley? You see, she's a cover girl.
Oh, I could see, I could see.
What magazine?
Oh, a lot of them. Thank you.
You know what they say in France, don't you? Champagne is the drink of the complexion. Hey, Biff.
Okay, sorry I'm late.
I just got here. Miss...
Forsythe.
Miss Forsythe, this is my brother.
Is Dad here?
His name's Biff. You might have heard of him. Great football player.
Really? What team?
Are you familiar with football?
No, I'm afraid I'm not.
Biff is a quarterback with the New York Giants.
Well, that is nice, isn't it?
Good health.
I'm happy to meet you.
That's my name. Hap. It's really Harold, but at West Point they called me Happy.
Oh, I see. How do you do?
Isn't Dad coming?
You want her?
Oh, I could never make that.
I remember the time that idea would never come into your head. Where's the old confidence, Biff?
I just saw Oliver.
Wait a minute. I gotta see that old confidence again. Do you want her? She's on call.
No.
I'm telling you, watch this. Honey, are you busy?
Well, I am, but... I could make a phone call.
Do that, will you, honey? And see if you can get a friend. We'll be here for a while. Biff is one of the greatest football players in the country.
Well, I'm certainly glad to meet you.
Come back soon.
I'll try.
Don't try, honey. Try hard. Isn't that a shame now? Beautiful girl like that. That's why I can't get married. There's not a good woman in 1,000. New York is loaded with them, kid.
Pap, look.
I told you she was on call.
Just cut it out, will you? I want to say something to you.
Did you see Oliver?
Oh, I saw him all right. Now, look, I want to tell Dad a couple of things, and I want you to help me.
What, is he going to back you?
You're crazy. You're out of your goddamn head, you know that?
Why, what happened?
I did a terrible thing today, Hap. It's been the strangest day I ever went through. I'm all numb, I swear.
You mean he wouldn't see you?
Well, I waited 6 hours for him, see? Uh-huh. All day. He kept sending my name, and even tried to date his secretary, so she'd get me to him, but no soap.
Because you're not showing the old confidence, Biff. He remembered you, didn't he?
Well, finally, about 5 o'clock, he comes out. Didn't remember who I was or anything. Felt like such an idiot, Hap.
Then did you tell him my flounder idea?
He walked away. I saw him for 1 minute. I got so mad, I could have torn the walls down. How the hell did I ever get the idea that I was a salesman there? I even believed myself that I'd been a salesman for him. And then he gave me one look at it. And I realized what a ridiculous lie my whole life has been. We've been talking in a dream for 15 years. I was a shipping clerk.
What'd you do?
Well, he left, see, and the secretary went out. I was all alone in the waiting room. I don't know what came over me, Hap. Next thing I know, I'm in his office. Paneled walls, everything. Can't explain it. Hap, I took his fountain pen.
Jeez, did he catch you?
I ran out. I ran down all 11 flights. I ran and ran and ran.
Well, that was an awful... What'd you do that for?
I don't know. I just wanted to take something. I don't know. He You gotta help me, Ap. I'm gonna tell Pop.
You crazy? What for?
Happy's gotta understand that I'm not the man somebody lends that kind of money to. He thinks I've been spiting him all these years and it's eating him up.
That's just it. So you tell him something nice.
I can't.
Say you got a lunch date with Oliver tomorrow.
Yeah, so what do I do tomorrow?
You leave the house tomorrow and you come back at night and say Oliver's thinking it over. And he thinks it over for a couple of weeks. And gradually it fades away and nobody's the worse.
It'll go on forever.
That is never so happy as when he's looking forward to something. Hello, Scout.
Gee, I haven't been here in years.
Stanley.
Sit down, Pop. Yeah, you want a drink?
Sure, I don't mind.
Let's get a load on.
You look worried.
Stanley, scotch all round. Make it doubles.
Doubles, right.
You had a couple already, didn't
yeah,
you?
Just a couple, yeah.
Well, what happened, boy? Everything go all right?
Pal, I had an experience today.
Terrific, Pop.
That's all. What happened?
I'm going to tell you everything from first to last. It's been a strange day. I had to wait quite a while for him.
Oliver.
And when he... Yeah, Oliver. All day. It's a matter of cold fact and a lot of instances. Facts, Pop. Facts about my life came back to me. Who was it, Pop? Whoever said I was a salesman with Oliver?
Well, you were.
No, Dad, I was a shipping clerk.
But you were practically...
Dad, I don't know who said it first, but I was never a salesman for Bill Oliver.
What are you talking
Let's
about?
Let's hold on to the facts tonight, Pop. We're not going to get anywhere bulling around. I was a shipping clerk.
All right, now listen
Why don't
to
you
me.
Let me finish?
No, I'm not interested in stories about the past or any crap of that kind, because the woods are burning, boys. You understand? There is a big blaze going on all around. I was fired today.
How could you be?
I was fired. And I'm looking for a little good news to tell your mother. Because the woman has waited and the woman has suffered. The gist of it is that I haven't got a story left in my head, Biff. So don't give me a lecture about facts and aspects. I'm not interested. Now, what have you got to say to me? Did you see Oliver?
Oh, Jesus, Dad.
All right, you mean you didn't go there?
Sure, he went up there.
He did. I saw him. How could they fire
All right,
you?
What kind of welcome did he give you?
What, he won't even let you work on commission?
No, I'm out. So tell me, he gave you a warm welcome.
Sure,
well,
sure.
It was kind of...
Well, I was wondering if he'd remember you. Imagine, man doesn't see him for 10, 12 years and gives him that kind of a welcome.
Damn right.
Pop, look
you know why he remembered you, don't you? Because you impressed him in those days.
Let's talk quietly and get this down to the facts, huh?
Right, well, what happened? It's great news, Biff. Did he take you into his office, or you talked to him in the waiting room?
Well, he came in to see
you. Yeah, and what did he say? I bet you he threw his arm around
well,
you.
Well, he kind of...
He's a fine man. Very hard man to see, you know.
Oh, I know.
Yeah, is that where you had the drinks?
Yeah, he gave me a couple of... No, no.
He told him my Florida idea.
Don't interrupt. How do you react to the Florida idea?
Dad, will you give me a minute to explain?
I've been waiting for you to explain ever since I sat down here. Of what happened? He took you into his office and what?
Well, I talked and he listens.
Yeah, well, he's famous for the way he listens, you know. Well, so what was his answer?
Well, his answer? What? Dad, you're not letting me tell you what I want to tell you.
You didn't see him, did you?
I did see him.
So, what, do you insult him or something? You insulted him,
Listen,
didn't you?
Will you let me out of it? Will you just let me out of it?
What the hell?
Will you tell me what happened?
I can't talk to him.
Mrs. Loman! Mrs. Loman!
Tell him what happened.
Shut up and leave me alone.
No, you had to go and flunk math.
What math? What are you talking
Mrs.
about?
Mrs. Loman!
Math.
Mrs. Loman!
If you hadn't flunked, you'd have been set by now.
Now, look, I'm going to tell you what happened, and you're going to listen to me. I waited 6 hours.
What the hell are you saying?
I kept sending him my name, but he...
Mrs. Loman!
So finally...
Biff flunked math.
No.
The Birnbaum flunked him. They won't graduate him.
But they have to. He's got to go to the university. Where is he? Biff?
I know he left. He went to Grand Central.
Grand... You mean he went to Boston?
Is Uncle Willie in Boston?
Oh, maybe Willie can talk to the teacher. Oh, the poor boy.
So, I'm washed up with Oliver. You understand? Are you listening to me?
Yeah, sure. Oh, if you hadn't flunked...
Flunked what? What are you talking about?
Don't blame everything on me. I didn't flunk math, you did. What pen?
That was awful, dumb, Biff. Pen like that is worth...
You took Oliver's pen?
Dad, I just explained it to you.
You stole Bill Oliver's fountain pen?
I didn't exactly steal it. That's just what I've been explaining
to
you.
He had it in his hand, and just then Oliver walked in, so he got nervous and stuck it in his pocket.
My God, Biff!
I never intended to do it, Dad. Dad, I'll make good. I'll make good. Sit down.
No, you're no good. You're no good for anything.
I am, Dad. I'll find something else. You understand? Now, don't worry about anything. Talk to me, Dad.
No, no.
Pop, listen. Listen to me. I'm telling you something good. Oliver talked to his partner about the Florida idea. You listening? He talked to his partner, and he came to me, and I'm going to be all right. You hear, Dad? Dad, listen to me. He said it was just a question of the amount.
Then you got it.
He's going to be terrific, Pop.
Then you got it, haven't you? You got it. You got it.
No, no. Look, Pop, I'm supposed to have lunch with him tomorrow. I'm just telling you this so you'll know I can still make an impression, Pop, and I'll make good somewhere, but I can't go tomorrow, see?
Why not? You simply...
But the pen, Pop!
You give it to him and tell him it was an oversight.
Sure, have lunch tomorrow.
I can't say that.
You were doing a crossword puzzle and accidentally used this
pen.
Listen,
kid, I took those balls years ago, and I walk in with his fountain pen. That clinches it, don't you see? I can't face him like that. I'll try elsewhere.
Don't you want to be anything?
Oh, Pop, how can I go
you
back?
You don't want to be anything. Is that what's behind it?
Don't take it that way. Do you think it was easy walking into that office after what I've done to him? A team of horses couldn't have dragged me back to Bill Oliver.
Then why did you go?
Why did I go? Why did I go? Look at you. Look at what's become of you.
Biff, you're going to that lunch tomorrow.
No, I can't go. I've got no appointment.
Biff, are you spiting me?
Don't take it that way, goddamn.
You rotten little louse. Are you spiting me?
Someone's at the door, Willy.
I'm no good. Can't you see what I am?
Hey, you're in a restaurant now. Cut it out, both of you. Hello, girls. Sit down.
I guess we might as well. This is Letta.
Willy, are you going to wake up?
How are you, miss? Sit down. What do you drink?
Letta might not be able to stay long. I got to get up very early tomorrow. I got jury duty. I'm so excited. Were you fellas ever on a jury?
No, but I've been in front of them. This is my father.
Isn't he cute? Sit down with us, Pop.
Oh, sit him down, Biff.
Yeah, come on, slugger. Drink us under the table. The hell with it. Come on, sit down, pal.
Willy, are you going to answer the door?
Hey, where are you going?
Open the door.
The door?
The washroom. The door. Where's the door?
You just go straight down.
Willy? Willy, are you going to get up?
I think it's sweet you bring your daddy along. Oh, he isn't really your father.
Miss Forsyth? You've just seen a prince walk by. A fine, troubled prince. A hard-working, unappreciated prince. A pal, you understand? A good companion, always for his boys.
That's so sweet.
Well, girls, what's the program? We're wasting time. Come on, Biff, gather around. Where would you like to go?
Why don't you do something for him?
Me?
Don't you give a damn for him, Hap?
What are you talking about? I'm the
I one sense
who...
it. You don't give a good goddamn about him. You could help him. I can't. Don't you understand what I'm talking about? He's gonna kill himself. Don't you know that?
Don't I know? Me.
Help him, Jesus. Help him. Help me. Help me. I can't bear to look at his face.
Hey, where are you going?
What's he so mad about?
Come on, girls. We'll catch him up.
Say, I don't like that temper of his.
He's just a little overstrung. He'll be all right.
Don't answer. Don't answer.
Don't you want to tell your father?
No, that's not my father. He's just a guy. Come on. We'll catch Biff. And honey, we're going to paint this town.
Will you stop laughing? Will you stop?
Aren't you going to answer the door? He'll wake the whole hotel.
I'm not expecting anybody.
Why don't you have another drink, honey? Stop being so damn self-centered.
I'm so lonely.
You know, you ruined me, Willie. From now on, whenever you come to the office, I'll see you go right through to the buyers. No waiting at my desk anymore, Willy. You ruin me.
Oh, that's nice of you to say that.
Gee, you're self-centered. Why so sad? You are the saddest, self-centered soul I ever did seesaw. Come on, back to bed, drummer boy. Silly to be dressing in the middle of the night. Aren't you going to answer the door?
They're knocking on the wrong door.
But I felt the knocking, and he heard us talking in here. Maybe the hotel's on fire.
It's a mistake.
But tell him to go away.
No, there's nobody there.
It's getting on my nerves, Willy. There is somebody standing out there, and it's getting on my nerves.
All right, but stay in the bathroom there and don't come out. I think there's a law in Massachusetts about it, so don't come out. It may be that new room clerk. He looked very mean, so don't come out. It's a mistake. There's no fire.
Why didn't you answer?
Biff, what are you doing in Boston?
Why didn't you answer? Been knocking for 5 minutes. I called you on the phone.
I just heard you. I was in the bathroom and had the door shut. Did anything happen home?
Dad, I let you down.
What do you mean?
Dad,
Biffa, what's this about? Come on, let's go downstairs and get you all malted.
Dad, I flunked math.
Not for the term.
The term. I haven't got enough credits to graduate.
You mean to say Bernard wouldn't give you the answers?
He did. He tried, but I only got a 61.
And they wouldn't give you 4 points?
Birnbaum refused, absolutely. I begged him, Pop, but he won't give me those points. You got to talk to him before they close the school, because if he saw the kind of man you are, and you just talk to him in your way, I'm sure he'd come through for me. The class came right before practice, see, and I didn't go enough. Would you talk to him? He'd like you, Pop. You know the way you could talk.
You're on. We'll drive right back.
Dad, good work. I'm sure I'll change it for you.
Now go downstairs and tell the clerk I'm checking out. Go right down.
Yes, sir. You see, the reason he hates me, Pop, one day he was late for class, so I got up at the blackboard and imitated him. I crossed my eyes and talked with a lisp.
You did? The kids like it?
They nearly died laughing.
Yeah? What did you do?
The square root of 50th week. and in the middle of it, he walked in.
Hurry downstairs and...
Somebody in there?
No, that was next door.
So somebody got in your bathroom?
No, it's the next room. There's a party.
Can I come in? There's something in the bathtub, Willy, and it's moving.
You better go back to your room. They must be finished painting by now. They're painting her room, so I let her take a shower. Go back.
I've got to get dressed, Willy. I can't.
Just get out of here. Go back. This is Miss Francis, Biff. She's a buyer. They're painting her room. Now, go back, Miss Francis. Go back.
But my clothes. I can't go out naked into the hall.
Get out of here. Go back.
Where's my stockings, Willy? You promised me stockings, Willy.
I have no stockings.
You had 2 boxes a size 9 shears for me, and I want them.
Here, for God's sake, now, will you get out of here?
I just hope there's nobody in the hall. That's all I hope. Are you football or baseball?
Football.
That's me, too. Good night.
Well, better get going. I want to get to the school first thing in the morning. Get my suits out of the closet. I'll get my valise. What's the matter? She's a buyer. Buys for J.H. Simmons. She lives down the hall. They're painting. You don't imagine. Now listen, pal. She's just a buyer. She sees merchandise in her room, and they have to keep it looking just so. All right. Get my suits. Now stop crying and do as I say. I gave you an order, Biff. I gave you an order. Is that what you do when I give you an order? How dare you cry? Oh, look, Biff. When you grow up, you'll understand about these things. You mustn't... Come on, you mustn't overemphasize a thing like this. I'll see Birnbaum first thing in the morning.
Never mind.
Never mind? He's going to give you those points. I'll see to it.
He wouldn't listen to you.
He certainly will listen to me. You need those points for the U of Virginia.
I'm not going there.
Huh? Well, if I can't get him to change that mark, you'll make it up in summer school. You've got all summer to...
Dad.
Oh, my boy. Dad. Silver. She's nothing to me, Biff. I was lonely. I was terribly lonely.
You gave her Mama's stockings.
No, I gave you an order.
Don't touch me, you liar.
I apologize for that.
You fake. You phony little fake. You fake.
No, I gave you an order, Biff. Come back here or I'll beat you. Come back here. I'll whip you. I gave you an order.
Hey, let's pick it up. Pick it up, Mr. Loman.
Your boys left with the chippies. They said they'll see you home.
But we were supposed to have dinner together.
Can you make it?
Well, sure I can make it. Do I look all right?
Sure, you look all right.
Here's a dollar.
Oh, your son paid me. It's all right.
No, take it. You're a good boy.
Oh, you don't have to.
Here's some more. I don't need it anymore. Tell me, is there a seed store in the neighborhood?
Seeds? You mean like to plant?
Yeah. Carrots, peas.
Well, there's hardware stores on 6th Avenue, but maybe too late now.
Oh, I better hurry. I've got to get some seeds. I got to get some seeds right away. Nothing's planted. I don't have a thing in the ground.
Hey, what you doing up? Where's Pop? Is he sleeping?
Where were you?
We met two girls, Mom. Very fine types. Oh, here. We brought you some flowers. Put them in your room, Ma. Now, what you do that for? Mom, I want you to have some flowers.
Don't you care whether he lives or dies?
Come upstairs, Biff.
Go away from me. What do you mean, lives or dies? Nobody's dying around here, pal.
Get out of my sight. Get out of here.
I want to see the boss.
You're not going near him.
Where is he?
You invite him to dinner. He looks forward to it all day. And then you desert him there. There's no stranger you do that to.
Why, he had a swell time with us. Desert him? I hope I don't outlive the day.
Get out of here!
Now look, Mom.
Did you have to go to women tonight? You and your lousy, rotten whores?
Mom, all we did was follow Biff around trying to cheer him up.
Boy, what a night you gave me.
Get out of here, both of you, and don't come back. I don't want you tormenting him anymore. Go on now, get your things together. You can sleep in his apartment. Pick up this stuff. I'm not your maid anymore. Pick it up, you bum, you. You're a pair of animals. Not one, not another living soul would have had the cruelty to walk out on that man in a restaurant.
Is that what he said?
He didn't have to say anything. He was so humiliated, he nearly limped when he came in.
But, Mom, he had a great time with us.
Shut up!
You didn't even go to see if he was all right.
No, didn't. Didn't do a damn thing. How'd he like that, huh? Left him babbling in a toilet.
You louse, you.
Now you hit it on the nose. The scum of the earth, and you're looking at him.
Get out of here.
I gotta talk to the boss, Mom. Where is he?
You're not going near him. Get out of this house.
We're gonna have an abrupt conversation, him and me.
You're not talking to him. Will you please leave him alone?
What's he doing out there?
He's planting the garden.
Now? Oh, my God.
Carrots, quarter inch apart. Rows, 1 foot rows. 1 foot. Beets. Lettuce, 1 foot. What a proposition. Terrific. Terrific. Because she suffered, Ben. The woman has suffered. You understand me? A man can't go out the way he came in, Ben. A man has got to add up to something. You can't... You gotta consider now. And don't answer so quick. Remember, it's a guaranteed $20,000 proposition. Now look, Ben. I want you to go through the ins and outs of this thing with me. I've got nobody to talk to, Ben. And the woman has suffered. You hear me?
What's the proposition?
It's $20,000 on the barrelhead. Guaranteed. Gilt-edged. You understand?
You don't want to make a fool of yourself. They might not honor the policy.
How can they dare refuse? Didn't I work like a coolie to meet every premium on the nose? And now they don't pay off. Impossible.
It's called a cowardly thing, William.
Why? Does it take more guts to stand here the rest of my life? Ringing up a zero?
Well, that's a point, William. And 20,000, that is something one can feel with a hand. It is there.
Oh, Ben, that's the whole beauty of it. I see it like a diamond shining in the dark, hard and rough, that I can pick up and touch in my hand. Not like an appointment. This would not be another damn fool appointment, Ben, and it changes all the aspects. Because he thinks I'm nothing, see? And so he spites me. But the funeral... Ben, that funeral will be... massive. They'll come from Maine, Massachusetts, Vermont, New Hampshire. All the old-timers with the strange license plates. That boy will be thunderstruck, Ben, because he never realized I am known. Rhode Island, New York, New Jersey. I am known, Ben, and he'll see it with his eyes, once and for all. He'll see what I am, Ben. Oh, he's in for a shock, that boy.
He'll call you a coward.
No, that would be terrible.
Yes, and a damn fool.
No, he mustn't. I won't have that.
He'll hate you, William.
Oh, Ben. How do we get back to all the great times? It used to be so full of light and comradeship and the sleigh riding in the winter and a ruddiness on his cheeks. And always some kind of good news coming up. Always something nice coming up ahead. And never even let me carry the valises in the house. And simonizing that little red car. Why can't I give him something and not have him hate me?
Let me think about it. I still have a little time. Remarkable proposition. But you gotta be sure you're not gonna make a fool of yourself.
Where the hell is that seed? You can't see nothing out here. They boxed in the whole goddamn neighborhood.
There are people all around here. Don't you realize that?
I'm busy. Don't bother me.
Saying goodbye to you, Pop. I'm not coming back anymore.
You're not going to see Oliver tomorrow.
Got no appointment, Dad.
He put his arm around you and you've got no appointment.
Pop, get this now, will you? Every time I've left, it's been a fight that sent me out of here. Today, I realized something about myself and I tried to explain it to you. And I think I'm just not smart enough to make any sense out of it for you. I mean, hell with whose fault it is or anything like that. Let's just wrap it up, huh? Come on in, we'll tell Mom.
No, I don't want to see her.
No, come on.
No, I don't want to see her.
Why don't you want to see her?
Don't bother me, will you?
What do you mean you don't want to see her? You don't want them calling you yellow, do you? This isn't your fault. It's me. I'm a bum. Now come inside. Did you hear what I said to you?
Did you plan, dear?
All right, we had it out. I'm going, and I'm not riding anymore.
I think that's the best way, dear. Because there's no use drawing it out. You'll just never get along.
People ask where I am and what I'm doing. You don't know and you don't care. That way it'll be off your mind and you can start brightening up again, all right? That clears it, doesn't it? You gonna wish me luck, Scout? What do you say?
Shake his hand, Willie.
There's no necessity to mention the pen at all, you know.
I've got no appointment, Dad.
He put his arm around...
You're never going to see what I am, so what's the use of arguing? If I strike oil, I'll send you a check. Meantime, forget I'm alive.
Spite, see?
Shake hands, Dad.
Not my hand.
I was hoping not to go this way.
Well, this is the way you're going. Goodbye. And may you rot in hell if you leave this house.
Exactly what is it that you want from me?
I want you to know, on the train, in the mountains, in the valleys, wherever you go, that you cut down your life for spite.
No.
Spite!
No!
Spite is the word of your undoing. And when you're down and out, remember what did it. When you're rotting somewhere beside the railroad tracks, remember. And don't you dare blame it on me.
I'm not blaming it on you.
I won't take the rap for this. You hear?
Yeah, that's just what I'm telling you.
Oh, you're trying to put a knife in me. Don't think I don't know what you're doing.
All right, phony. Then let's lay it on the line. Now, Biff! Leave it there. Don't move it.
What is that?
You know goddamn well what that is. A rubber tube.
I never saw that.
You saw it. The mice didn't bring it into the cellar. Well, what's this supposed to do? Make a hero out of you? This is supposed to make me sorry for you?
Never heard of it.
There'll be no pity for you. You hear it? No pity.
Hear the spy?
No, you're going to hear the truth. What you are and what I am.
Stop it!
Spy, you cut it out now.
The man don't know who we are. The man is going to know. We never told the truth for 10 minutes in this house.
We always told the truth.
Oh, you big blow. Are you the assistant buyer? You're one of the two assistants to the assistant, aren't you?
Well, I'm practically...
You're practically full of it. We all are, and I'm through with it. Now, hear this, Willie. This is me.
Oh, I know you.
You know why I had no address for 3 months? I stole a suit in Kansas City, and I was in jail. Stop crying, Mom. I'm through with it.
I suppose that's my fault.
I stole myself out of every good job since high school.
And whose fault is that?
And I never got anywhere because you blew me so full of hot air I could never stand taking orders from anybody. That's whose fault it is.
Oh, I hear that.
Don't, Biff.
It's goddamn time you heard that. I had to be Boss Big Shot in 2 weeks, and I'm through with
it. Then hang yourself! For spite! Hang yourself!
No! Nobody's hanging himself, Willie. I ran down 11 flights with a pen in my hand today, and suddenly I stopped. You hear me? And in the middle of that office building, do you hear this? I stopped in the middle of that building, and I saw the sky. I saw the things that I love in this world. The work, and the food, and time to sit and smoke. And I looked at the pen and said to myself, what the hell am I grabbing this for? Why am I trying to become what I don't want to be? What am I doing in an office making a contemptuous, begging fool of myself when all I want is out there waiting for me the minute I say I know who I am? Why can't I say that, Willie?
The door of your life is wide open.
Pop, I'm a dime a dozen, and so are you.
I am not a dime a dozen! I am Willy Loman! And you are Biff Loman!
I am not a leader of men, Willy, and neither are you! You were never anything but a hard-working drummer who landed in the ash can like all the rest of them. I'm $1 an owl, Willy. I tried 7 states and couldn't raise it $1 an hour. Do you gather my meaning? I'm not bringing home any prizes anymore, and you're gonna stop waiting for me to bring them home.
You vengeful, spiteful mutt.
Pop, I'm nothing. I'm nothing, Pop. Can't you understand that? There's no spite in it anymore. I'm what I am, that's all.
What are you doing? What are you doing? Why is he crying?
Will you let me go? For Christ's sake. Will you take that phony dream and burn it before something happens? I'll go in the morning, just... Put him to bed.
Isn't that remarkable? Biff, he likes me.
He loves you, Willy.
Always did, Pop.
Oh, Biff. He cried. Cried to me. Oh, that boy
is going to be magnificent.
Yes, outstanding, with 20,000 behind him.
Now, come to bed, Willie. It's all settled now.
Yeah, we'll sleep. Come on, go to sleep, Hap.
And it does take a great kind of a man to crack the jungle.
I'm getting married, Pop. Don't forget it. I'm changing everything. I'm going to run that department before the year's up. You'll see, Mom.
The jungle is dark, but full of diamonds, Willie.
Be good. You're both good boys. Just act that way. That's all.
Night, Pop.
Come, dear.
One must go in to fetch a diamond out.
I just want to get settled down, Linda. Let me sit alone for a little.
I want you upstairs.
In a few minutes, Linda. I couldn't sleep right now. Go on. You look awful tired.
Not like an appointment at all. A diamond is rough and hard to the touch.
Go on now. I'll be right up.
I think this is the only way, Willie.
Sure. It's the best thing.
Best thing.
The only way. Everything is going to be all. Go on, kid. Get to bed. You look so tired.
Come right up.
2 minutes. Loves me. Always loved me. Isn't that a remarkable thing? Ben, he'll worship me for it.
It's dark there, but full of diamonds.
Can you imagine that magnificence? With $20,000 in his pocket.
Willie, you coming up?
Yes, yes, I'm coming. It's very smart. You realize that, don't you, sweetheart? Even Ben sees it. I gotta go, baby. Bye-bye.
Imagine. When the mail comes in, he'll be ahead of Bernard again.
Perfect proposition all round.
Did you see how he cried to me? Oh, if I could kiss him, Ben.
Time, William, time.
Oh, Ben. I always knew one way or another we were going to make it, Biff and I.
The boat. We'll be late.
Now, when you kick off, boy, I want a 70-yard boot. And get right down the field under the ball. And when you hit, hit low and hit hard because it's important, boy. There's all kinds of important people in the stands. And the first thing you know, you'll... Ben? Ben? Where do I... Ben, how do I...
Willie, you coming up? Willie? Willie, answer me. Willie!
Pop!
No!
Pop!
Getting dark, Linda.
How about it, Mom? Better get some rest, huh? I'll be closing the gates soon.
You had no right to do that. There was no necessity for it. We would have helped him.
Come along, Mom.
Why didn't anybody come?
It was a very nice funeral.
But where are all the people he knew? Maybe they blame him.
No, it's a rough world, Linda. They wouldn't blame him.
I can't understand it. At this time, especially. First time in 35 years we were just about free and clear. He only needed a little salary. He was even finished with the dentist.
No man only needs a little salary.
I can't understand it.
There were a lot of nice days. When he'd come home from a trip... Or on Sundays, making the stoop, finishing the cellar, putting on the new porch, when he built the extra bathroom and put up the garage. You know something, Charlie? There's more of him in that front stoop than in all the sales he ever made.
Yeah, he was a happy man with a batch of cement.
He was so wonderful with his hands.
He had the wrong dreams. All wrong.
Don't say that.
He never knew who he was.
Nobody dares blame this man. You don't understand. Willie was a salesman. And for a salesman, there is no rock bottom to the life. He don't put a bolt to a nut. He don't tell you the law or give you medicine. He's a man way out there in the blue, riding on a smile and a shoe shine. And when they start not smiling back, That's an earthquake. And then you get yourself a couple of spots on your hat and you're finished. Nobody dares blame this man. A salesman has got to dream, boy. It comes with the territory.
Charlie, the man didn't know who he was.
Don't say that.
Why don't you come with me, Happy?
I'm not licked that easily. I'm staying right in this city. I'm going to beat this racket. The Loman brothers.
I know who I am, kid.
All right, boy. Well, I'm going to show you and everybody else that Willy Loman did not die in vain. He had a good dream. It's the only dream you can have, to come out number one man. He fought it out here, and this is where I'm going to win it for him.
Let's go, Mom.
I'll be with you in a minute. Go on, Charlie. I want to, just for a minute, I never had a chance to say goodbye. Forgive me, dear. I can't cry. I don't know what it is, but I can't cry. I don't understand it. Why did you ever do that? Help me, Willy. I can't cry. It seems to me that you're just on another trip. I keep expecting you. Willy, dear, I can't cry. Why did you do it? I search and search and I search, and I can't understand it, Willy. I made the last payment on the house today. Today, dear. And there'll be nobody home. We're free and clear. We're free. We're free. We're free.
In Death of a Salesman by Arthur Miller, Willy Loman was played by David Suchet and Linda Loman by Zoë Wanamaker. Biff was Daniel LePayne, Happy, Brendan Patricks, Charlie, Tony Turner, Bernard, Adam Best, Uncle Ben, Simon Coons, The Woman, Lucy Black, Howard, John Mackay, Letter, Laura Rogers, and Miss Forsyth, Florence Hall. Other parts were played by members of the cast. The Penny Whistle was played by Wilf Dalton. Technical presentation was by Eloise Whitmore. Death of a Salesman was directed by Howard Davies, and the producer was Chris Wallace. It was a Watershed production for BBC Radio 3, and it was part of a whole season across Radios 3, 4 and 4 Extra, celebrating Arthur Miller's centenary. Over on Radio 4 this week, they're covering the life and times of Arthur Miller with four plays based on events in his life. They're being broadcast from Monday to Thursday afternoons at 2:15. Here on Radio 3, we've got five essays called Staging Arthur Miller. We'll be airing those every night starting tomorrow at 10:45. 10:45. 10:45. 10:45. 10:45. 10:45. 10:45. 10:45.